She completed her master degree with neuroscience as elective in Seth GS Medical College under the University of Mumbai. She has around 16 years of experience in the field of occupational therapy. She is presently working as occupational therapist in JIFMA, Government of India, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Puducherry. She also worked as tutor in SRM College of Occupational Therapy, Chennai in the year 2003, and also worked as occupational therapist for NIPMED, Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, Government of India, Puttukad, Chennai for 3 years. She had presented and won a national paper in 46th IOTA conference at Ahmedabad in January 2010. She has done many post-professional courses like Handwriting Without Tears in the year 2015. A hearty welcome to you, ma'am.
And thank you so much.
We request all our participants to kindly mute your mic and also bear with us if there are any technical issues encountered. And after the end of this session, there will be a question session conducted. So now I request Dr. Josemary Sangeeta to take over the session.
Thank you, Bilsi. Good evening, one and all. As she introduced, today's topic is going to be on guidelines for occupational therapy practice in flexor tendon injuries. Introduction. Hands are the eyes for those who cannot see, the words for those who cannot hear, and the tool which we use to sustain our life. This is told by Maureen Moylan. It is also the part of the body gifted with functions of grasp and prehension, with the help of which we can perform our day-to-day activities. So coming to flexor tendon injury, it is also in short called as FTI. The definition goes like this. It is a deep cut in the palm side of your fingers, hand, wrist or forearm, damaging the flexor tendons. So basically we have our palm of the hand. In the hand, if there is any injury happening, that will affect the flexor tendons. So what is a tendon? It is a fibrous connective tissue that attaches muscle to the bone. And tendon is also a part of a muscle. It transfers forces generated by muscle to bone, produces movement at joint, and any kind of lacerations that occur when the tendons experience a traumatic cut. Example, there can be a road traffic accident, or there can be a knife cut or accidental glass cut or a crush injury. All these things can lead to a flexor tendon injury. What is a flexor tendon system? It has two components. The first thing is the extrinsic component and the second is an intrinsic component. When you speak about the extrinsic component, you have flexor digitorum profundus, flexor digitorum superficialis, and flexor pollicis longus. FDP is used to flexing the DIP joint. FDS is used in flexing the PIP joint. And FPL is the flexes the IP joint of the thumb. And the intrinsic muscles are lumbricus. They flex the MCP joint and they extend IP joints. Coming to the anatomy, the tendons of the 9 digital flexors, why do I say 9? Because once the FDP and FDS, they enter the hand through the carpal tunnel, they go to each and every finger, medial 4 fingers they go into. So FDS will have 4 parts and FDP will have again 4 supply to the digits, and the 9th one will be the FPL, which goes to the thumb. The superficial most is the FDS. And the deeper ones are FDP and FPL. So if there is any problem with the carpal tunnel, that time also this flexor tendons will be affected. Anatomy, this FDP is inserted into the base of the distal phalanx. FDS is inserted on the sides of the middle phalanx, and FPL is inserted into the distal phalanx of the thumb. There's something called as camper's chiasma. You can see it in this. You can see it here. This nothing but the superficially running flexor digitorum superficialis. After entering the palm, it divides into two and it goes and attaches itself into the middle phalanx on both the sides. So that's what you can see, this campus chiasma. So this is the campus chiasma part, and FTP goes deeper to it. We also have to focus on something called as the fibro-osseous sheath. This fibro-osseous sheath is enclosing part of the tendons. The tendons are fully completely enclosed within this fibro-osseous sheath, and from the anterior to the metacarpophalangeal joint to the, up to the distal phalanges, the extension is there. It allows a smooth gliding of the tendon, and it also helps in facilitating the nutrition to the tendon by synovial diffusion. And the place where this fibro-osseous sheath is there, it is called as the no man's land, because however you do excellent surgery and if you give an excellent rehabilitation, the prognosis would be comparatively lesser to the other zones than in this no man's island. We have to see about a very important part of this flexor tendon system, which is the pulley system. The synovial sheath is reinforced by a system of fibrous pulleys. Actually, you have two forms of pulleys. One is the annular pulley and the other one is the cruciform pulley. The annular pulleys are five, like you can see your A1, A2, A3, A4 and A5, five annular pulleys, and you have the cruciform pulleys, which is three, C1, C2 and C3. What is the main function of this pulley is that the pulley holds the tendon close to the bones so that during flexion and extension of the fingers, there is no bowstringing happening. It will not let the tendons to fall off. It will not allow the tendons to slide off. So it holds the tendon tightly towards the bone. That's the main function of this pulley. And thereby, as it is holding, it increases the mechanical efficiency by preventing the bowstringing also. It is called as a cruciform pulley. See, it's called as cruciform pulley because it is in the cross crucifixion shape, and annular pulley you can find over the MCP joint, over the proximal phalanx, over the PIP joint, middle phalanx, DAP joint. And C1, C2, C3, that is the cruciform pulleys, are just proximal to the A3 and A4 and A5 pulleys. So this is the bowstringing. Can you see in this? See here, this A3 pulley is damaged, so it is not able to hold the tendon. So the tendon has slipped out from its original place. So this phenomenon is called as bowstringing. And you see here, it is intact. The fingers are flexing, the pulleys are intact, so the tendon is also intact. But here you see A3 is ruptured, pulley is ruptured, so the tendon has come outside. So this is bowstringing phenomenon. And the next is tendon nutrition. Talking about the nutrition supply, as I already told you, one is through the synovial diffusion, and the second thing is due to the vincula system, which is the slender tendinous band blood supply to the flexor tendon. There are two things, like vincula brevis and vincula longus. Both of them, they supply the nutrition for the tendons. And this is the most important slide. This is called as a flexor tendon injury zones. You have from the distal to the proximal, you have to see. Most distally, you have the zone 1, and the next you have the zone 2. As I already told you, zone 2 is also called as the no man's land. Here you find the A2 and A4 pulley, which is very, very important. And you also find the synovial sheath in this no man's land. And next comes the zone 3, which is called as the lumbrical zone. And then you have the carpal tunnel area, which is the zone 4. And then proximal to the carpal tunnel is called as the zone 5. So the same thing, from the tip of the finger to the FTS tendon is called as zone 1. And from the FTS tendon up to the distal palmar crease, this is the distal palmar crease, this is called as no man's island. And from the distal palmar crease up to the carpal tunnel area, it is called as the lumbrical origin, zone 3, which is the lumbrical origin, is there. And next, over the carpal tunnel, it is a zone 4. And then proximal to the carpal tunnel is a zone 5. This is very, very important, because based on this, our rehabilitation protocol will differ, and our expected outcome will also differ. Flexor tendon healing. Talking about the flexor tendon healing, you have two types of healing. One is the intrinsic healing, which occurs without the direct blood supply to the tendon. That is, by the synovial diffusion, the healing occurs here. And the second is the extrinsic healing. Here, the proliferation of fibroblasts happens, thereby adhesions occurring because of this extrinsic healing of the tendon can limit the flex gliding of the tendons with fibrous synovial sheath. And say about the flexor tendon, how long does it take to heal? From the date of injury, it takes about 12 weeks. It takes about 12 weeks for the flexor tendon to heal. Like for bones, we have about for 6 weeks, a fracture bone will heal, but tendon takes much longer time. Okay, this is about the intrinsic tendon healing. It has three phases. The first is the inflammatory phase, which is for up to 0 to 5 days. And here what happens? It starts immediately after the injury. In the 3 to 5 days, the tensile strength of the repaired tendon diminishes because of softening of the tendon. And softening does not occur in the tendon ends in case of early mobilization. So later softening ends leads to the scarring. And the next second phase is the proliferative phase, which is for up to 5 to 28 days. Here, fibroblasts migrate to the wound area and start production of tropocollagen approximately 5 days after the injury. And the last one is the remodeling phase, which happens after 23 days. Here, the collagen in the repair site remodels and continues to strengthen. Coming to the signs and symptoms of flexor tendon injury, the complaints could be like patient will say, I'm not able to bend my fingers. My fingers are paining, my hand is paining, and you can see a visible open cut and open injury in the hand. There can be swelling, edema can be there in the fingers and hand. Tenderness can also be present. So these are all the signs and symptoms. If the patient is complaining of numbness along with excessive bleed, then we can come to a conclusion that definitely there's some kind of a neurovascular insult. When this tendon injury happened, it can happen with isolated tendon injury, or it can also affect the neurovascular structures, causing median nerve injury and ulnar nerve injury also can happen along with it. Okay, timing of flexor or tendon repair. Flexor tendon injury, it's not a, even if they come to the emergency, it's not an emergency procedure. Like immediately you have to operate it. It's no, there is no hard and fast rule like that. If suppose it's only an isolated flexor tendon injury, you have a different protocol for it. That is primary repair is there. In the primary repair, what happens? It is within 24 hours, they do it. But this is contraindicated in case of high grade contamination, like an infection, and this primary repair is contraindicated. Delayed primary, you make no problem. There is a flexor tendon injury, no problem. You can wait up to 1 to 10 days. Once the wound scar is still pulled out, you can then the surgeon will do the delayed primary repair. Then early secondary is 2 to 4 weeks, and late secondary after 4 weeks. This late secondary, when does it happen? Means you find some people will come from a remote village. They will not mind after a small after a cut or injury. They will just treat with some local medicines. Later on, when they come to know after a month or so that their pain is not subsiding and still they have problems, that time only they report to the hospital. During that time, we do the late secondary repair. And all lacerations need not undergo repair. If the laceration is less than 25%, no repair is needed. And if the laceration is about 25 to 50%, that epitendon repair is done. And core suture plus epitendon repair is done when the laceration is more than 50%. And in all kind of things, there is a dorsal block splint can be used for 6 to 8 weeks as a conservative measure. And this is a point to remember. All of you can follow this. Flexor tendons need to glide large distances because this flexor tendon, they're originating from the elbow and they are coming down through the forearm and then they enter into the palm and then they go to the distal digits, distal part of the digits. So what happens? They have to it has to allow full digit flexion extension running with a tight pulley system to maximize the efficiency. Following repair, what happens? They become adherent to the surrounding tissue to form scar formation. Especially when there is damage in the pulley system, then the scar formation will be more and the adhesion will be more. Once adherent, they don't glide to perform active flexion, thereby limiting in the active range of motion and passive range of motion of the fingers. So factors affecting healing and rehabilitation is the patient related factors would be age. Young adults can show much better progress than the elderly people. Then the general health and the healing potential, like suppose the patient is having diabetes and all, the healing process will take a little longer time. Then the rate and quality of the scar formation. If the scar formation is more, then again it's a difficult. Patient motivation, socioeconomic status, and again the level of injury. If it is in zone 2 level, then again there is recovery is very low, and the type of injury also, and the sheath. In crush injuries and all, you cannot expect much kind of a better outcome, and surgical technique what they use, and even also the therapy related factors like timing, how well timely therapy they are being taking, and what are the techniques used, and what is the expertise given. All these things will affect the progress in rehabilitation. So coming to the examination, inspection, there is normal arcade. See, suppose when I'm making a fist, all of you can see my hand. This is called as a normal arcade. What happens? The flexion is more towards the little finger, and the flexion of the IPS is lesser on the index finger. But what happens in case of tendon injury, the complete fisting cannot happen, and this normal arcade will be affected. If this normal arcade is affected, then the surgeon will definitely suspect a tendon injury. So you can see here, they are examining. This is the test done for FDP, flexor digitorum profundus. What they do? They stabilize the PIP joint, and then they ask the patient to move the index finger. DIP movement, they ask to do flexion and flexion. Suppose if the patient is able to flex the DIP, then it means the FDP is intact. Suppose the patient is not able to flex the digit, it means the FDP is affected. And the next thing, this is for FDS. What they do, they stabilize all the fingers, and then they ask the patient to flex the PIP joint. Now this PIP joint, we are testing for FDS, that is flexor digitorum superficialis. And then coming to the FPL, what they do, they stabilize the metacarpopharyngeal joint, and they ask the patient to flex the thumb. If the thumb movement is present, tendon is intact. If the thumb movement flexion is not there, tendon is impaired. Okay, what are the goals of reconstruction? That is cooptation of the tendon, anatomical repair, and multiple strand repair to permit active range of motion. That is, while performing the sutures, they have multiple strand or double strand, like that you have different kinds of strands. Depending on that, the rehabilitation protocols efficiency will also change. Then the pulley construction to minimize the bowstringing, atraumatic surgical technique to minimize the adhesions, and strict adherence to the rehabilitation protocol. When it comes to the strict adherence to rehabilitation protocol, occupational therapy's role comes here. Okay, coming to the suture techniques, you see during the surgery, they perform all these kinds of different suture techniques. Like you have the two strand Bunnell suture, the first thing, and the next thing is the four strand interlock suture, and the last thing is the six strand suture. This the name core stitch is also called as Kessler grasping stitch, Indiana four stitch, and six stranded stitch. So based on this, our rehabilitation protocol will differ, because what happens here, this is only a two strand, so this two strand will not tolerate a vigorous exercise protocol in the initial phase post operatively. But when it comes to the four strand and when it comes to the six strand, because the strength is more, they can bear a lot of tensile force, and active rehabilitation can take place. So that's what research shows, that the more number of strands of suture material that cause the tendon repair, the stronger the repair. Example, two strand repair tolerates application of immobilization protocol or immediate passive motion protocol in early phase of tendon healing. Four strand is best for immediate active motion protocol, and six strand is also good for active motion protocol, but six strand, no, it demands a lot of technical knowledge, and it causes bulky, and it reduces the gliding friction. So mostly, most of the surgeons, they prefer going for a four-stranded suture. Points to remember, the occupational therapist must know the new what are the strands used in during the repair of the flexor tendon before determining what type of motion protocol will be appropriate. These are the core sutures I've already explained to you. And coming to the zone repair, in zone 1 repair, post-operative flexor tendon rehab possess challenge due to the pulley system present in zone 1 and zone 2. See here, this is the, they are playing rugby and football. So here, in such kind of games, the profundus tendon avulsion, that is FTP avulsion, can take place due to hyperextension. Here, it leads to the zone 1 injury. And zone 2 repair, like repair both tendons lacerations, that is FTP and FDS. Tendon sheath may be opened for exposure, but pulleys A2 and A4 are preserved as much as possible. And in zone 3 repairs, if both tendons are lacerated, both are repaired. And in zone 3, because the lumbricals are there, the lumbricals may also be affected along with the flexor tendons. And in zone 4, because it is over the carpal tunnel, the median nerve can also be affected in zone 4 repair. So they have to repair the median nerve first, and then they have to go for the tendon repair. And in zone 5 repair, here see, in zone 5, the concomitant ulnar nerve, ulnar artery, the radial nerve, median nerve, all these things can be affected. So the more proximally we go, more number of structures will be affected. So primary repair, they first repair this artery, nerves and all, and last they will do the tendon repair. So these are the guidelines for occupational therapy in rehabilitation of FTI. The first thing is evaluate the client's present level of injury and coordinate the treatment plans along discussing with the surgeons. Surgeons, orthopedic surgeon will also operate on FTI, and also plastic surgeon will sort of also do FTI surgeries. And analyze the client's environment, whether the client is able to perform well in his environment with the current problem, and fabricate a protective splint. Whatever's the appropriate splint for that patient, we have to fabricate it. Recommend a home exercise program and apply techniques in order to reduce the swelling, to prevent further healing, to care for the wound, and also to improve the movement. And show the client how to complete activities safely and independently while the hand is still being rehabilitated. And we also have to take into consideration the client's goals and desires into our treatment plans. So coming to occupational therapy assessment. Occupational therapy assessment can be divided into three components. The first thing is performance area, second is performance components, and then the third is performance context. When it comes to performance area, we will assess the ADL, work and leisure of the patient. And next is performance components, where we assess the person's sensory motor level, the cognition of the patient, and also the psychological status also we have to assess. When it comes to performance context, we have to see the temporal aspects like the age of the person and other stuffs like that, and environmental. How does the person manipulate the environmental hardware, furniture placed, and all those stuffs. And the social is the social support and whatever the patient gets from the social group. And the next thing is the evaluation of the hand. The aims of evaluation are decide on the priorities for treatment, monitor the progress, and also to keep records in case of possible litigations. Okay, hand evaluation comes like this. You have all these things. You can see the pain, a scar. For pain evaluation, we do the visual analog scale. And for scar, we see where's the location of the scar, whether it is a raised or a flattened scar. Then the wound, whether it's closed or eschar. Eschar is the dead tissue formed one. And sutured or open wound, we have to mention that. And vascular status like normal or pink, red, blue, white. What is the vascular status? Fixation devices, whether the patient is on internal fixators or whether the patient is devices is protruding through the skin. All those things we can see, like pins, use of orthotics, then swelling. You have to measure the circumferential measurement of the swollen area, range of motion, sensation, and strength. The functional use, strength has to be tested only after 12 weeks post-op, not before that. And functional use, ADL, and use of standardized tests can also be used, like Purdue pegboard, Jepson Taylor hand function test, and all those steps. See, this is an evaluation form. This is the evaluation form. You can see it. This is the next one, and the next page. If you want, I can give it to through Arun sir. And pain assessment scale, I said actually visual analog scale, that is can be implemented, the wound status. Then edema assessment can be done using measuring tape, can also be done. And scar status, whether it is adherent scar or a non-adherent scar. And range of motion. I'm sorry, I don't know why this line had come here. Can you help me out? One line has come here. And the range of motion. When you're speaking about one line has come here. When you're speaking about
one second, ma'am. Jonathan, can you tell ma'am how to autonomous setting or something you did before?
Ma'am, okay, it's clear. Okay, it's okay.
Okay. Range of motion, usually we have one position, we have to stabilize and all, no? When it comes to flexor tendon injury, post-operatively, we are not supposed to do range of motion as per how we were taught in our textbooks. Like we are supposed to do it in a tendon protective position. That is very minimally you have to test and grossly you have to test. You needn't measure the accurate ones. Like grossly if you test, whatever is possible within the available range of motion, that can be done. You should not ask the patient to overdo, because when you ask the patient to overdo, the sutures might rupture. And strength testing, as I already told you, strength testing should be done after 12 weeks to 14 weeks only. You are supposed to do strength testing. See, in this, the first picture you can see the pinchometer, and the second picture you can see the JAMA hand dynamometer. And sensory testing, the first one is monofilaments and second thing is a two-point discrimination. And also you can use the functional X-ray testing for during our assessments. And this functional dexterity testing should be done after 12 weeks. Functional assessment also after 12 weeks, in the sense like the main functional assessment. But the basic things can be done. Basic ADL and self-care can be done on the day one also. And pre-vocational testing after 14 weeks. Coming to the post-operative management, actually we have three, this is the most important part of flexor tendon injury. You can see this. There is three kind of a protocol. First is the immobilization protocol. Second is an early passive mobilization protocol. And the last is the early active mobilization protocol. These are the protocol. People at different years of time, they have done Kleinert in 1973, Durand protocol 1975, modified Kleinert, and it goes on like this. And still this Kleinert protocol has been used in many hospitals over India. Coming to the first protocol, this is the immobilization protocol. I already told you during the suture technique, when they are doing two strand suture, you cannot go into active motion protocol, you can't do. You should do only this immobilization protocol. Like Cifaldi and Collis, they developed this protocol. In this, what happens? From 0 to 3 weeks, 3 to 4 weeks, the patient should be immobilized using a dorsal block splint. Can you see the splint? Is it visible? Is the splint fully visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you for answering. And this immobilization protocol will have a slow progress. It will not give a drastic change and a faster rehabilitation. But still, why do we use this? We use this immobilization protocol for children who are below 12 years old. And for people with cognitive impairment, we can use immobilization protocol. And also in Alzheimer's disease, we use immobilization protocol. And also if there is fracture associated along with the flexor tendon, the fractured area has to be immobilized, no? So that time also we will use this immobilization protocol. So all of you, I'm just repeating it again. For children below 12 years, for cognitive impairment, Alzheimer's and fracture cases, we have to use this immobilization protocol. And here I told you the dorsal block splint is being used immediately post-operatively. The wrist is kept in 10 to 30 degrees of flexion. An MCP joint is kept in 40 to 60 degrees of flexion, and IP joint is kept in a full extension. So this is a dorsal block splint, and we also give the patient home exercises like uninvolved joints. We'll ask the patient to move, like the elbow joint and the shoulder joint. We'll ask the patient to move. And the next thing is the first thing we saw about the early stage, 0 to 3 to 4 weeks. Now this is the intermediate stage. Intermediate stage is 3 to 4 weeks is intermediate stage. Now what happens here? The orthosis is modified to bring the wrist in neutral. Initially the wrist was in slight flexion, but now we are giving another splint for him, so that making the wrist into neutral. And we teach the patient to remove the orthosis in hourly basis to do the exercises. The exercises are taught in this intermediate phase is wrist at 10 degrees of extension. Patient will perform passive digit flexion and extension followed by active tendon gliding exercises. So this is the tendon gliding exercises. Always remember, tendon gliding exercises should be done at 3 to 4 weeks. That or at you just keep for roughly at around 1 month. You can keep it like this. Post-operatively, tendon gliding exercises will be done at around 1 month, 3 to 4 weeks. So that is the first thing is fingers straight out, and the second is make a hook fist. Third is make tabletop position. Fourth is make a straight fist, and the fifth is make a full fist and repeat as directed. So this is the tendon gliding exercise. If you do regularly this tendon gliding exercise at appropriate repetitions, we can prevent the adhesions and stiffness of joints also. Okay, after this 3 to 4 days of these exercises, the tendon function has to be evaluated again. So what we are supposed to do, we have to measure the active and passive flexion of MCP and ICP, MCP and IP joints. If there is discrepancy more than 50 degrees between the total active and passive flexion, we will come to a conclusion that the gliding is poor. That is, tendon gliding, what is happening post-operatively is very poor, and the adhesion formation has already happened and it is more. And we coming to the next stage, that is the last stage, starting at 4 weeks. Orthosis, what we give is dorsal block will be discontinued. The splint will be discontinued. No more need to be given. And if flexor muscle tendon unit shortening is a problem, then patient can wear forearm based palmar night splints. Like suppose if there is a contracture or shortening, the flexor muscle is not able to fully glide, we can also give a volar splint for the night time to be used, which hold the wrist and fingers in maximum comfortable extension. Okay, now this is the late phase. In the intermediate phase, at 3 to 4 weeks, we gave tendon gliding exercise. Now this is the late phase, that is after 4 weeks. After 4 weeks, we can start with blocking exercises. Blocking exercises, I showed you one slide, no, how we are supposed to test FDP and FDS. The same test only here. You have to support the proximal part and ask the FDP movement to be done and FDS movement to be done. And you have to repeat it into 10 repetitions so that it becomes a gentle blocking exercises. And immobilization, you can, this is just chart to show the immobilization program, what all happens between 3 to 4 weeks, 4 weeks, 4 to 6 weeks, and 8 weeks. By 8 weeks, you can start with gentle resistive exercise program. And now that's immobilization protocol is over. The first protocol is over. Now we are going to the early passive mobilization. This early passive mobilization is a best treatment of choice for zone 2, especially the two-strand procedure can be used here also. Here what happens, why did they go for an early passive mobilization? Because they found like this will inhibit the restrictive adhesion formation, and here it promotes the intrinsic healing and synovial diffusion is more, and it can lead to a stronger repair, preventing decrease in the tensile strength. So this is the early passive mobilization, that is the second protocol. You have two methods you can do. One was done by Duren and Hauser, that is the first method, and the second method was done by Kleinert and colleagues. First we'll come to the Duren and Hauser method. In this, the early stage is 0 to 4 to 5, 4.5 weeks. Here the orthosis given is wrist is given in 20 degrees flexion, and MCP will be in 50 to 60 degree of flexion, and IP is straight. And in Duren, what happens, they are demonstrating 3 to 5 mm glide in is sufficient to prevent adhesion. That's what they say. and they do something called as a Duren and Houses exercises, which is repeated twice a day for 6 to 8 repetitions. So this is the post-operative passive Duren exercises. What they do, they passively flex the DIP and PIP. And you can see difference of passive exercises for FDP and FDS, both they are doing. And Duren's protocol, that is early stage is over. Coming to the next is intermediate stage. Intermediate stage will start at 4.5 weeks, up to 8 weeks it can go. The orthosis, first we were using dorsal block splint. Now the dorsal block splint, we have taken it out. Now this dorsal block splint is replaced by a wrist band with rubber band traction. You see in this picture, the wrist band is there, and also the fingers, it is attached with the rubber band traction. So that what will happen? The patient can move the wrist movement also can be done, along with finger movement will also take place. You know what happened? Gentle active extension against the rubber band traction. Active flexion also takes place. We can do the blocking and guiding and fisting also. It's initiated. And in the later stage, after 8 weeks, we can start with resistive flexion exercises. In all these different protocols, only the 3 to 4, up to 0 to 4 weeks, there will be a change. But after that, all protocols will have almost similar rehabilitative exercises followed. And what happens? This is the late stage. This is the third stage. In Duren's protocol, the patient begins with gentle blocking exercises. And this blocking exercise is performed 4 to 6 times a day with 10 repetitions. And also, we check after a week if active flexion has not improved, then we can upgrade into the towel walking. You can see the picture, the fingers, we can do, we can shrink the towels and move the fingers like towel walking. And we can also do light pickups and gentle putty squeeze can also be done. And this should not exceed 10 repetition, only 10 repetition has to be done when we are doing with lightest putty. The putty resistance should be very, very light. It should not be a high resistance putty. And in the late phase, in another week, sustained gripping activities can be done. We can ask the patient to do a light lifting of little bit heavy objects like a quart of milk like that and so on. And but a heavy manual job is contraindicated up to 12 weeks. The heavy weights has to be lifted after 12 to 14 weeks only. So this is the modified Duren protocol. This is again a modified version of the original Duren. What they do, they eliminate the rubber band traction. Instead of that, they give a BBS hood splint like the one which you see in this picture. There is passive flexion to individual joints. Active IP extension exercises are being given. Passive exercises described in the original protocol is continued here also. And tenodesis, protective tenodesis exercises can also be given here. So this is the Duren protocol. You can see and go through just rough thing. You can go through. Then Kleinert protocol. This is my favorite because most of the Indian hospitals, they prefer to do Kleinert protocol. Even in my hospital, they stick on to this. Though it is a early passive mobilization, still they stick on to this because it's relatively traditional and it also brings into equal good effects like compared to the active protocol also. What happens in Kleinert? It combines a dorsal extension block with rubber band traction proximal to the wrist. Originally, using a nylon loop, but nowadays we can do it with the ordinary rubber band which we can get in the stationary store also. What happens? I can just show you. See, this is the Kleinert splint. It is also called as dynamic motion blocking splint. What happens? You can see the nail in all the nails. You find we can use the quick fix. Using the quick fix, we stick the hooks which we use for the blouses and all. No, that hooks is being stuck to each and every fingernail nail tip. Then from there, you have to in the hook you have to insert the rubber band. And you have to put a pin on the forearm wrist support, and then you have to pull it into traction. So what will happen when the patient extends? There will be resistive extension and assistive flexion. It will go into passive flexion. Automatically, the fingers will go into flexion because of the rubber bands pulling it. But extension, the patient has to do resistive extension. So by doing this also, it is good for the program. This is a modified Kleiner splint. You can see this is the Kleiner splint and this is the modified one. In modified one, what you can see a palmar pulley which is placed nearby. So that is the only difference. And another difference is that, see, in this picture, you can see for all the four fingers, you find the rubber bands. That is, all the four tendons are being affected. But here, only a single tendon of the middle finger is affected. That's why of the ring finger is affected. That's why only for one finger they have given the splint loop. Okay, so what is the difference between the original Kleiner and modified Kleiner is that in the original Kleiner, the wrist flexion is about 45 degrees, but here in the modified, wrist flexion is up to 20 degrees only. And MCP flexion in original is about 10 to 20 degrees, whereas in modified, it is up to 40 degrees. You can flex the MCPs. And in original, you use the rubber band traction directly to the fingernail, whereas here, they use a palmar pulley in between. So exercises is patient actively extends the fingers to limit of the orthosis every hour for four times they do. In the 0 to 4 weeks, there is active IP extension against rubber bands. And 3 to 6 weeks, you can start removing the splint, remove splint for wrist motion at 4 weeks and begin gentle active flexion. And 6 weeks, you can discontinue the splint totally and add differential tendon gliding exercises. And from 8 weeks on, you can start off with resistive activities. And again, when you talk about the discontinued splint, we can see if there is a flexor lag, again, here also you can give a volar palmar splint can be given to be used as a night splint. So see, this is the active range of motion rehabilitation using the Kleiner splint. This is the program in short. Okay. This table shows all the protocols, that is a complete immobilization, passive mobile motion, early active motion. There is another thing called as controlled active motion. But because it is just a general basic class and guidelines, I cannot, we may not have time to tell each and everything, and too much of anything will not retain any knowledge in your brain too. So better I'll just talk the basics of everything. So this is the last protocol, that is the third protocol. This is called as early active mobilization. So again, I'm reminding you the same thing. Suppose if the patient comes with you, you're supposed to see the what strand of suture has been the surgeon has done. Suppose the surgeon has done a two strand suture, you are not supposed to give early active mobilization, because once you start with early active mobilization, the suture will be ruptured and tendon also will be ruptured. Suture will be removed and the tendon will rupture. So for early active mobilization, at least a minimum of four standard suture is very much essential. So that you should keep in mind. Why they went into this early active mobilization means the Kobuta and co-workers during their investigation and research, they found out the breaking strength, investigating the breaking strength and increase in cellular activity, it is produced by early mobilization. And they also found that early mobilization without tension on the rib bag was not as effective as active mobilization. So they concluded active mobilization will give a stronger rib bag than the passive and immobilization protocol. And synovial diffusion will increase more. And but one more thing, for this early active mobilization, the surgeon's expertise is also very, very important. And we have to always keep in, we have to ask whatever doubts you have regarding the surgery, you can ask the surgeon and you can discuss the rehabilitation program along with the surgeons too. So here what happens, the wrist position is slight in extension. So far we have seen in passive and all, we saw the wrist is in flexion only, but now you see in early active mobilization, the wrist position is in slight extension and the eccentric tendons are given slack at the wrist, allowing the fingers to relax in partial flexion. Only slight pull by the muscle, which will help the flexors to flex properly. So goal is to attain light fist that includes DIP flexion to ensure FDP gliding and not a tight fist. Suppose the patient is doing a tight fist, again, the tendon will rupture. So we should be very, very careful when we are handling post-operative clients with tendon repair. And this is again in this early active phase, you have different protocols. The first protocol is Belfast and Sheffield's. early stage 0 to 3 to 4 weeks. Here the postoperative cast is given with wristing 20 degrees of flexion, MCP 80 to 90 degrees of flexion and IP full extension. And exercises is done for zone 3 and zone 4, 24 hours and 48 hours immediately post repair. And exercises performed every 4 hours within the orthosis consists of full passive flexion, active flexion and active extension of the fingers. You have an intermediate stage which is at 4 to 6 weeks. The orthosis, discontinue the orthosis at 4 weeks if tendon glide is poor. And exercise is given list like in presence of flexion contracture, the only exercise specified for this is protective passive IP joint extension. And small and associates, they stated using blocking exercise to increase the tendon glide at 6 weeks. And Cullen and colleagues initiated progressive resistive exercises and moderate to heavier hand use after 8 weeks up to 12 weeks. And this is the next protocol. This one is gone. Now this is the second type of active, early active mobilization protocol. This is called a Strickland Cannon active hold place hold mobilization. Here what happens, the digits are passively placed in flexion so that the patient maintains that flexion with gentle muscle contraction. So that is what it's called as place and hold. So passively we have to keep the fingers in flexion. The patient will just maintain it for few seconds and causing gentle muscle contraction, and then they will leave it. Patient learn to use only minimal force by practicing with the uninjured hand, and also use biofeedback to monitor the strength of contractions. And early stage, it will be up to 0 to 4 weeks of splint. Here two different splints are used. One is a dorsal blocking splint, and another is they use also a tenodesis splint. Also uses the tenodesis splint will what it causes along with the wrist flexion, finger extension will happen, and along with wrist extension, finger flexion will also happen. And this full digit flexion and full IP extension are allowed, but MP extension is limited only to 60 degrees alone. See here, this is this place and hold I told you, na? We have to passively flex the fingers, then the patient has to hold it for few counts, like 15 repetitions we have to do it passively, PRO movement, and 25 repetitions the patient will do the place hold digit flexion using the tenodesis splint. So this is the picture you can see, and the same thing I've explained, this is in the tabular form, active hold digit flexion passively, then the biofeedback the patient gets. Okay, after the early stage is over, coming to the intermediate stage, it is from 4 weeks to 8 weeks. Here the tenodesis splint is discontinued. Patient still wears the dorsal blocking splint except for tenodesis exercise alone. This exercise is given once in every 2 hours with 25 repetitions, and also followed by 25 repetitions of active flexion and extension exercise for the wrist and digits also. And at 5 to 6 weeks, blocking and hook fist may be added if needed to improve tendon gliding. And in the later stage, that is starting at 7 to 8 weeks, the splint is totally discontinued and exercises given as progressive resistive exercises started. And we can ask the patient to resume the activities of daily living with no restrictions by 14 weeks. Okay, this is called as a Strickland evaluation system for flexor tendon repair. So this is just to measure what is the range of motion that is in that we have achieved from the day one post surgery up to the final day of rehabilitation. So how it has to be calculated is DIP plus PIP active flexion minus the DIP and PIP extension deficit. You have to divide it by 175 degrees multiplied by 100. This will give into the percentage of normal DIP and PIP active motion. So if it is coming within 75 to 100, then it means we have attained an excellent improvement has been achieved for the particular affected injured tendon. And if it is 50 to 75, it is good. If it is 25 to 49 score, it is fair, and it is less than 25, it is poor. Usually poor prognosis, I already told you, in zone 2 injuries, there is you cannot expect much prognosis. And this is called as a progression of exercise, that is growth and associates. they had done some investigations and research. They found out this pyramid of progressive forces. What they did, begin with exercises that result in least force to the tendon repair with gradual increase in tension when gliding is limited. So they started with passive flexion and protective extension. They did place and active hold and flexion, and then they go to active fist hook and straight fist, and last they do resistive blocking exercises. So this is the pyramid of progressive forces that is being applied by Groth and Associates. When additions limit active flexion more than passive flexion, advance to the next level of exercises. So this is the main thing, like, when should I advance to the next exercises means, when we find there is a scar tissue form, there is additions, and this additions are limiting the active flexion, which is, and the passive flexion is more, that time we have to move on to the next level of set of exercises. And points to remember, if the client is having good early active mobilization, then we have to delay the resistive exercises because the additions are very few here. But on the same time, like, if the client lacks motion due to additions, if there is too much of additions are there and the client cannot do much of movement, so that time we can start the resistive exercises sooner. The reason is because resistance is introduced appropriately when additions limit active motion more than passive motion in an effort to place tension on the scar to improve the proximal gliding of the tendon. So that time you can introduce the resistance when there is addition is there, because the tension will be placed on additions and it will loosen. The same resistance may overpower the tensile strength and may cause rupture. So we have to do it very guarded. Tension has to be applied to the movements of the fingers. And other things are, if a client has good very early active motion, the same thing I've just repeated here. And these are some of the hand function activities can be done with therapy and other kind of strengthening activities and pegboards and all. I'm not going into much depth of it because the protocol is more easy, important. Once you know the protocol, you can give any kind of activities based on it. And FPL, this is for the thumb. So long we were doing for the digits, and this is the last thing which you are doing for the FPL repair for the thumb. Dorsal block orthosis is given, holding the CMC joint in relaxed position and avoiding the extension. And MP joint will be in 30 degrees flex, and IP will be in extension. Wrist will be in 20 to 30 degrees of flexion in passive flexion protocol, and wrist in neutral for the active flexion protocol. Brown and McGrath established exercises stabilize MP joint while passively flexing and extending the IP joint. That is the gliding exercise for this FPL tendon. Okay, what are the complications that we can see postoperatively? We can see joint contractures, that is a flexor contracture can be done. Here you can see there is a PIP flexor joint, flexor contracture happening here in the ring finger. And also the DAP is also contracted, and stiffness can also be there. Additions can be there, rupture can be there, and infection can be there. These are all postoperative complications which can delay the rehabilitative process as well. For this contracture, what can you do? You can use a volar splint, gutter splint can be used in order to straighten the contracture. Little by little, serious splints can be made. But in case if there is not a significant improvement in the contracture, again, they have to go for a contracture release surgery. There is something called as a quadriga effect. Quadriga effect, what means? Suppose even if not all the tendons are affected, even if one or two tendons are affected, the adjacent tendon will also not be able to flex fully. So that is called as a quadriga effect. So this leads to a weak grasp. There is loss of flexion in other digits, and the patient may not be able to make a full fist. See, the normal fist you can see in one side, and the quadriga effect can be found in the other picture. So treating this adhesion problems, you can, by giving appropriate blocking exercises, tendon gliding exercises, sustained grip activities and therapeutic squeezing, we can treat the adhesions problems. And also, as I already mentioned, suppose if the adhesion is there and contracture is there, they have to do another surgery. That has to be done. They'll wait up to 4 months. They'll wait 4 to 6 months only. After the first initial repair, after 4 to 6 months only, they'll do the contracture release surgery. Okay, this is the case study. 25-year bartender. Diagnosis is injury to the volar surface of a small finger of right hand. Glass cut injury, then zone 2. Here the surgery performed is four-strand repair. Now the protocol you'll be, all of you will be knowing, that is four-strand repair can tolerate active protocol. So immediate active flexion protocol has been given. Post-surgery, dorsal block orthosis was given with wrist in neutral, MP flex and IP extended. And orthosis was supposed to be worn all the time at home. They can remove it during the therapy, and wrist tenodesis exercises was given with 30 degree wrist extension and gentle passive flexion as tolerated with the flex fingers laxed. And passive flexion and place and active hold exercises was also given. And initial OT evaluation showed that moderate swelling was there in small finger, so elevation was given. And PROM of the small finger was 70 degree at MP joint and 70 degree at PAP joint and 50 degree at DAP joint. The patient attended therapy twice weekly. And also at 4 weeks postoperatively, the MP and PAP and DAP joint degrees ranges has improved to 75, 85 and 55. And on the 12th week, it improved to 90, 90 and 70. So this is how you can find the progress. And that by 8 weeks, we had taken off the initial splint was replaced by the hand-based orthosis. And after 12 weeks, the patient also started to going to the regular duty after performing a pre-occasional evaluation. So this is case study 2. This is again, and there is an injury to two fingers, that is to the middle finger and the ring finger. And this is a Kleinert. You can see this is a Kleinert protocol. Here in JIPMA, we used to give a POP slab along with hoops and rubber bands also. This both FDS and FTP tendon is being injured. So you can see in the first picture, the patient is able to keep the fingers in flexion. And in the second picture, you can see the patient is trying to make the full fist with the rubber band. The patient is not able to do. And this is done on the second picture is taken around 4 weeks post-op, after around 4 to 5 weeks post-op. And the third and fourth picture is shown after 6 weeks and 8 weeks respectively. Now you can see the difference. See the picture, the second picture and fourth picture, you can see the increase in range of motion. And that's how the improvement we get. And also you in the last picture, you can see the quadriga effect. The patient is not able to make the full fist. Still there is lag. And you can see this. Oh, I'm sorry. It is a video. I'll just try to play the video. Oh, excuse me. Just a minute, I'll just play the video for you. This is the last video. Can you see the video?
No, ma'am.
Can you see, Arun sir? Can you see the video?
No, ma'am. We cannot see, ma'am.
Video is not available, ma'am.
Vinci and Arun sir, can you see the video?
No, ma'am.
No. You are not able.
We cannot see.
Yeah, 1 minute.
Only the desktop only showing.
is done post operatively. Can you see the video?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am. We cannot see the video.
Sir, left out to come here.
Hello. So, sorry for the inconvenience. So, when ma'am comes back, then after that session, we will continue with questions. Okay. So, when the participants are asking questions, please unmute your mic and then ask. Or else you can type it and post your questions in chat. And when the question session is going on, I request the participants, except Savita College of Occupational Therapy students, to post your name and your email ID, clear email ID and your name, so that we can send you certificates. Okay, thank you. During question session, okay?
So, ma'am, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Tell me about what. Can you hear me now? Okay, I'll just when you're asking the question, answer session, I'll just try. So the next thing is the references. So I basically collected notes from Cynthia and Cooper, Fundamentals of Hand Rehabilitation. And hand rehabilitation by Gaylord and Clark, and also rehabilitation of hand by Hunter. So this is all the references that I want to give to you. Anybody is interested in learning more about hand rehabilitation, you can refer these books. And that's it. Thank you. You can, if you have any doubts, you can contact me in this mail ID anytime, and I can respond whenever I'm free. And that's it. That is the end of the session. Can you, if you have any doubts, you can ask me. Hope all of you understood, and this is a very difficult topic, and it's very vast and huge. Also, on the very first time, it will be difficult to understand and keep everything in memory. But once you start practicing, and once you start reading about it again, you will remember it very well. And I would like to give my sincere, heartfelt thanks to Principal Savita College, Dr. Arun Kumar, my friend, my batchmate. And thank you for giving me this opportunity to be in this webinar. Thank you, Arun sir.
Thank you, Jos.
Hello?
Vinci.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So, yes. Open to question. Now, the session is open for questions. As I said before, I'll repeat it once again. please unmute your mic and you can ask question, or else you can type your questions and send through chat. In the meanwhile, I request the participants to type your full name clearly and your email ID also together and post it here in the Zoom chat. And you can also post your valuable feedback. So thank you, and it's open for question now.
Unmute and introduce yourself and ask a question.
And now I want to ask question. Did everybody understand something?
Unmute your video. Just unmute your video.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Did everyone understand? Can I hear a few?
Yes, ma'am.
Very informative, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Good, you were. And you can ask a question.
I'm trying to retrieve that video. I don't know how to play it. Can anybody help me by the meal time to play the video? How?
Questions. The good topic regarding the orthopedic. So students and the therapist can ask the question. They clarify the doubts. You can, through chat message, you can ask your question.
Ma'am, left, sir.
Those?
Yes, Arun sir, I'm here.
Yeah, you can see the chat also. There is some questions also, chat message.
Okay. Okay, yeah, I'm getting it very much.
Ma'am, I have a question, ma'am. Good evening, ma'am. Actually, it was a very elaborate and very informative for us. This is the first time we are hearing that occupational therapy has a role in, like, specific to this tendon injuries. And thank you for this valuable presentation, ma'am. And also, in this tendon injury, during this tendon injury, if a patient or if any either male or female, how can he cope up with this ADL, that is daily activities of daily living, ma'am? As we concern on, as we are an OT, we'll concern on that. So, also we have to educate them about their ADL. So, if he is a right-hand dominant, he will be difficult in eating, so such kind of things. So, how we have to do that for the patient?
You're asking mainly for ADL, right?
Sorry, ma'am?
You're asking for ADL and functional activities.
Sorry, ma'am, can't understand.
No, you're asking for how the patient will be able to do the ADL and functional tasks, right, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am. Exactly.
Okay. What happens, mostly they will not have much of a problem. They will have difficulty, but very little, because usually they will, only one hand will be affected. So with a non-affected upper limb, they will do all, they can do dressing, they can do eating and bathing, everything they'll do with the unaffected arm. That is one thing. And especially while donning and doffing off, we will ask them patient to first put the shirt sleeve on the affected hand. And then second on the unaffected hand. Those things, principles you would have learned, right?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Those all the strategies you have to follow here. And while lying down in the bed, we'll ask the patient to lie down on the unaffected side lying position initially. And in supine position, we'll ask the patient not to sleep on the prone position. That is one more thing. And apart from that, they will manage with the one hand itself. But there will be a definite restriction in ADL when the patient comes with a bilateral hand injury. So that time it will really be a problem. Initial phase, when the patient is in immobilization phase, they may not be able to do any activities. They will be totally dependent on the caretaker. And for the initial 0 to 4 weeks, we will not ask the patient to try any kind of functional activities. We'll say, okay, it's okay to be dependent for some time because your tendons have to heal. You have been recently operated. you have to bear with us all, you have to bear with all these things. We tell them all the stuff, and as the patient is improving, we will give ADL training starting from 12th week postoperatively. Before 12th week, we will not give ADL training in case of bilateral hand injuries. You got it, ma'am?
Okay, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Even after, okay. suppose the patient is having bilateral hand injury, and the patient is having after 12 weeks, the everything is rehabilitation protocol is over. Still, the patient is having weakness. If suppose still the patient is having a problem with grasp, the patient is having flexor contracture and all, the patient is not able to use the hand effectively. That time, yes. We can give them adaptive devices. We can give them adaptive devices according to the problems. Okay. Suppose if there is no movement at all in the fingers, we can give them the universal cuff. And suppose if the grasp is affected, only partial grasp is present, we can give them large handle spoons to eat and large handle pen to write, and all those things. Whatever is relevant, you can bring in here.
But these equipments should be, they have to practice in the unaffected hand only, no, ma'am. They can't use this affected hand, right?
This tendon injury, mostly they will recover, nearly 80 to 90% recovery will be there. Usually in tendon injuries, we don't give any adaptive devices and we don't give anything. Suppose in some rare cases, the patient is having tendon injury along with a crush injury, along with a fracture, where the prognosis is very low. During that time only, we'll ask the patient, suggest the patients about ADL adaptive devices and all. Okay.
Okay.
The patient is having one limb unaffected, he will do everything using the unaffected limb itself. Okay, most of the patients, they do avoid using the splints, they avoid using adaptive devices, they don't like. Especially we get patients from the remote villages now, they don't do it. They'll have the stigma and all. Suppose if a marked problem is there and the patient is right hand dominant, the patient is not able to hold the pen, the patient is not able to, that time they will accept using large handle devices and all. You got it?
Okay, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Hello, ma'am.
Oh, yeah, tell me, ma'am. In the meanwhile, I'll try to play in the video.
Yes, you can see the questions in chat.
Questions, yeah, I see. Dr. Arun, can you see the video? Is it there available? Can you see it?
No, Josh.
No.
Kindly introduce yourself and you can ask the question.
Desktop? Arun, can you see my desktop, Dr. Arun?
No, only the slide. Time to slide only I can see. I think you close the PPT and you can open the video. There are questions in the chat message. What is the progress of Zone 2 repair?
Okay. Zone 2 repair, usually the prognosis is quite low, but this low is, I'm comparing to the zone 1 and 3, 4 and 5. It's comparatively low, but still functionally the patient will be able to do all the activities. They will be having weakness will be there, grasp problem will be there. But then what else? The quadrige effect will be found in zone 2. All those things will be there.
You able to see the questions in chat message?
Yeah,
I'm asking questions.
Because lot of messages are there in chat, sir. I think the participants can unmute yourself and ask. Hello? Yeah, the participants, please unmute yourself instead of typing, because lot of messages are there. difficult. And please introduce yourself, and then you can ask your question.
Yes, someone asked it. Try to ask. There's one question there. Now we can use the Manchester protocol, which is a new protocol, then the Kleiner protocol. How we can use it? It is useful in plasma and an injury.
Between Kleiner protocol and active, okay. I'm talking about with respect to my hospital. So I had a talk recently with a plastic surgeon. So I asked them, what are the why aren't they doing this active protocol? Why they are not doing? So what did our hospital surgeons, they tell me is that, they told me is that, they said, for our patients, they do only this two-strand protocol and they use Duren and Kleiner, two-stranded sutures technique they are using. They are not using four-stranded and they're not using six-stranded and eight-stranded. So the reason what they told was, when they are performing the four-stranded, six-stranded and eight-stranded suture technique, there is increase in blood loss. So there is rupture of more amount of arteries. So again, the healing process will take time. So it is not giving a proper results as when considered to our hospital. So that's what they said, we will stick on only with Kleiner. And even though there are various protocols, all protocols are almost similarly, they give similar progress only they give. You cannot say this protocol is very poor and this protocol is the best. We cannot say just like that. It all depends on the surgeon's decision and his expertise and his skills only. We can use Kleiner protocol. We can use active rehabilitation protocol also. In some hospitals like Sion Hospital in Mumbai, they are using active protocol because their surgeons, they prefer using that kind of a surgery. So it all depends on the surgeon's decision only. So according to their decisions, we are supposed to do the rehabilitation, and whatever rehabilitation measures we have done, we have not found any drastic change between different protocols. Almost it is same only. I hope I answered.
Okay, hello? Okay, just someone raised their hand. Dr. Sandesh Kumar Chauhan, do you have any questions to ask? You can mute your mic and you can ask the question.
Stop cases, ma'am. So when can we start? One person has asked, Vandiya Devan, can we start individual finger movements in post-op cases, ma'am? If so, when to start? So I told you, by 1 month, we can start teaching the tendon gliding exercises. And after 4 weeks, we can start with blocking exercises. That blocking exercise is nothing but individual finger movements because we are blocking the stabilizing and moving it. So individual finger movements can be done post-operatively, maybe around 5 to 6 weeks we can start off with. And the next question is such an elaborate occupation therapy rehabilitation. Any other questions? Can you unmute and ask? One more thing I have to tell, like in early Kleiner protocol, maybe adhesions formations can be there, but in active mobilization, adhesion formation will be very less. That is one thing. And one more thing is tendon rupture, if the protocol is not being followed, will be more in active protocols, but tendon ruptures will be less in Kleiner protocol. Traditional approaches is a bit, you can say, a safe travel. Any other doubt?
question?
Those there are questions. From Niti Dev. Very well explained, ma'am. We got a broad overview starting from the basic anatomy and current updated protocol to be followed. Ma'am, what grade of therapy can be started with and how to be progressed? What grade of therapy can we start with and how to be progressed?
Okay. Actually, therapeutic exercises we can start postoperatively around 6 weeks. We can start off with 6 to 8 weeks. We can start off with any kind of a protocol. We can start with the 6 to 8 weeks. Initially, you go for the least resistive ones. Gradually, you can increase it. You have the color gradings, no? You have that lightest color. That one you can start off with. Later on, as the week is progressing from 1 week to another week, you can change in the colors.
And question, what is the role of serial printing for the flexor tendon injury?
What is the role of?
Serial.
I cannot hear.
Serial.
Huh?
S-E-R-A-L, serial printing.
Serial splinting, usually we don't use in flexor tendon injury, but in one case we use. When means, suppose the whole rehabilitation is over, the whole 12 weeks is over, the patient is going, but if we find the patient is having flexor tendon contracture is there, that time we can give a splint called as Robert Jones splint. This Robert Jones splint is a serial splint only. It is a hinged splint. It will have a hinge around the wrist joint. So it is a volar splint and it is a caged splint. There is a cage on top of it on the dorsal aspect. You can just browse in internet and your mobile and you can see Robert Jones splint. And as there will be a strap which is coming on the volar aspect, you have to take and buckle it on the cage dorsally. So that after every week, you can just increase the range of motion in the wrist and thereby also increasing the range of motion in the flexor tendon also, in the IPs of the fingers. So that kind of long flexor contraction and long flexor tightness, you can use the serial splints. Example, Robert Jones caged splint. You can use it.
Then next question is, if tendon injury will be associated with nerve injury and there will be a sensation loss. So what we have to focus first and what precautions we have to follow, what are the do's and don'ts for the therapist and suggestion for the progression of each zone?
Okay, I got the question. So when there is a nerve repair along with the tendon repair, initially, our focus will be on both, but more emphasis we have to give it on the nerve repair also. So, we have to ask the surgeons like what time we are supposed to do. We can start with the tendon. Initially, they'll allow the nerve repair to happen first. I mean, treatment for the nerves focus. We have to focus on that. Like example, if it's a median nerve injury, my whole focus mainly initially will be 90% on the median nerve and then a little bit on the tendon. As I already said, the tendon delayed repair is also accepted, but whereas in the nerve exploration, we have to do it very quickly. So that time my concentration will be on sensory re-education. Usually here we sensory re-education, all of you will be knowing now, there is a cortical representation of the sensation in the brain. By giving different textures, like different protocols, we can make the sensory re-education happen. And then along with it, we can give the tendon protocol also can be followed. But more emphasis on the nerve. Because again, for the nerve, they will be giving a different splint. It is a little bit difficult situation, but the emphasis will be on the median nerve injury first and then on the second on the tendon.
Next question is, ma'am, you say that some people are living in rural area and they came hospital late, and after, what is that treatment process and which protocol became appropriate?
Okay. See, they come after 4 weeks. That time they do late primary repair they do. So usually I told you, in my hospital they are following only one suture technique, that is two standard suture. They do that and we follow Kleinert protocol. But the outcome will be comparatively lesser than the initial time, than they coming on the immediately after the injury. You got it, na? If they are coming after 4 weeks, it is too much of time waste is there. So improvement will definitely be there, but it will be lesser than the other time.
No.
Yeah. Any
other? Next. Why there is a specific indication in immobilization protocol for Alzheimer's and cognitive impaired person?
Okay, see in early active protocol and all, what happens, the splint will be removed in between. Before the 3 to 4 years, the splint will be removed in between. We'll be teaching the wrist tenodesis action, and the wrist tenodesis action will be done only with the wrist 20 degrees of flexion extension movement will be there. And I also mentioned about gentle movement on the fingers, not to cause tendon rupture. But in patients who are having cognitive problem, in patients who are having Alzheimer's disease, they will forget or they will not understand. So they will not know how many degrees to move the wrist and how much to move the fingers and all. So if they will do any action, they can do even weight bear on using the hands. They can suddenly lift some objects because their cognition is affected. So what will happen immediately? Rupture of tendon will happen. So that's why for them, immobilization protocol is best. The limbs will be mobilized for up to 0 to 4 weeks solid. After that, we can train them little by little.
There is a question from Facebook. Jonathan? Jonathan? No touch.
Sir.
Question, Facebook question.
Somebody was asking about the Teraputina. Initially, you can start with extra soft tan color. That is what is initially given. A Teraputi, what is given initially is double extra soft tan color, followed by extra soft yellow color. And then you can go to medium soft red color, and then medium firm green, and then the firm blue, and extra firm black. This extra firm black will be done after 14 weeks, not before that.
Hello, ma'am. Yeah. I have one question, ma'am. Ma'am, are these protocols same for pediatric clients, or do we have any indications or contraindications?
For pediatric clients, only one protocol is used, ma'am. That is the immobilization protocol. Active protocols are not used for pediatric clients. Only immobilization protocol is used.
We'll stop with the question session, sir.
Yes.
Okay. So I now request Dr. Arun Kumar, Principal, Savita College of Occupational Therapy, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Good evening to all, for the all participants. I thank my friend, my batchmate, Savita Alumni, Dr. Josemary Sangita, for the excellent presentation. Because in orthopedic OT role and this much elaborate way, I think before no one can explain this much of explanation. So it's a very helpful and very motivating for upcoming students and therapists to enrich the knowledge in the field of orthopedic rehabilitation, especially occupational therapy. There are many roles we are playing in orthopedic. So thank you so much, Jose, to so very practically, and is very, it shows how much experience and how much you are passionate in the field in orthopedic and rehabilitation in the hand. So thank you very much, and you spend the time for the
thank you, Dr. Arun, for giving me
student and the participant.
Thank you, all the participants, for your patient listening.
So thank you very much. I thank the coordinating officials and all the participants. Orthopedic. So thank you very much, Joshua Sangeeta. Thank you all participants for patiently watch the videos and the answer questions. Thank you so much. Okay, Josh.
Yeah, thank you, doctor.
Feedback, all the things and all. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
thank you all for we are now closing the session. Thank you. See you again. Thank you, Joseph. Call Kundra. Yeah. Sanatan.
Yes, sir.
Sanatan Saravanan, the office governor is line.
Okay, sir. Now the Facebook live up off from here.
Vinci. Sanatan, keep on it.